follow-up question. So when an applicant applies for, applies to incorporate an exempt company, and they put that in their description, the nature of your business is to facilitate trading, or even if you have an exempt with a civil license granted for trading cryptocurrency, I mean, how does the ministry and SEMA look at that? Because at the end of the day, they're going to need a bank account to support their business. And, you know, they do have relationship overseas. So, you know, we have our internal policies, but at the same time, we're having to explain to these applicants that, you know, we can't take on the business because we don't really have a regulatory framework in place locally, in addition to, you know, working with a group to make a decision on turning away these applicants. So when the companies are being incorporated, is the nature of the business being considered?
Not at this time. Until we address the regulatory framework, there's nothing to potentially prevent that from happening. I think the sort of common understanding of cryptocurrency and unless being the ICOs, there is a way to look at it from the current regulatory framework where AML sort of has to be applied, status should be maintained. Just because they're a new thing, they can be seen in some sense as security or otherwise, and therefore existing framework should apply. But because we don't have a legislation in place to address that, it is that gap we're trying to address right now. And that's what, as Mr. said, we're reviewing to see what the next step should be to move quickly to make sure we have captured and regulated the process.
I'm sure, I think Bermuda, has draft legislation or something on the pipeline, or something like that. They've already drafted something, I think, and there's another jurisdiction on it.
In respect of the CFATF's evaluation in December, is there or are there any preliminary findings you're able to share with us today?
Not really. He's only seen the very first draft, and that's where the state what the mitigations are. You can understand, we have a team come here for basically 2 weeks, which was an intense set of meetings every single day. All day long, right, stakeholders, reviewing all our laws, talking to sort of key stakeholders. It's a lot for them to sort of absorb and synthesize and assess us against these international standards. The first report, therefore, was the first pass of trying to make sure that they understood all of that. And what I would say is that we did see some gaps in terms of understanding where they sort of missed things being done. And the first draft was about our opportunity to correct some of those misperceptions, their understanding, and by next week we see the second draft, hopefully then we sort of understand sort of the key issues that they found. Hopefully what then in the over the next few months is as we discuss and fine-tune the report and work with them, they put their understanding, then by the second draft that they produce, we will have a very clear idea of what issues we need to tackle next. If we can't then this then change their mind on the sort of issues. There is a sort of quality review process. There are other viewers who are coming in to make sure that the work of the core review team is on par and consistent with other works being done for other jurisdictions. But I don't think we're going to be in a position to know what actions are next from the AML standpoint and how the work of the industry to address those concerns ahead of the plenary referendum. I think perhaps some work towards may have a better sense of what these actions are going to be. And then work with the industry to figure out what the next step on the water
sector. Any other questions? Just go one here. Sorry, Dr. Castillo, can you say a little bit about what the government is willing to do with respect to BEPS and whether BEPS is really not much of a threat and if everything's okay, or whether there is something that we need to be concerned about and what are you doing about it?
Two minimum standards that speak to them directly. One of them is to actually be looking around the room and represent the most important ministry for most people in this room. It's a ministry that oversees an industry that contributes over 50% of GDP, as you said earlier, Tara, over 40% of government revenues. And previously the Department of the Ministry of Finance, last government established it as a ministry in its own right. So you're the second minister to head that department. I think the area for Cayman faces the biggest risk is the financial services industry as an economic sector. I think there's limited opportunity across the spectrum of Cayman to spread that risk by developing new industry and economic services, so to speak, for the broader community and the world. So protection and development of financial services is critical. I also accept that government revenue and the distribution of that revenue to the ministries is a zero-sum game. You all have to fight to get your dollar. So if it comes from health to financial services, then you have to fight the cause, so to speak. So really, I'm really sort of sitting here thinking that at the end of the day, given the risks to this industry, given the fact that it's 50-something percent of GDP, 40% of government revenue, employs over 4,000 Caymanians, the level of investment for the government in the ministry, I think, needs to be enhanced. And I totally respect what you have done in assisting Cayman Finance with funding for this year and next year. First time we've had anything meaningful. But I think it's critical that it's understood and that we get it across to the local community, the importance of financial services, and a lot of work has been done in that respect. At the end of the day, without financing for your ministry and without onward financing for the private sector, I'm fearful that it potentially becomes too late and these risks start overtaking the industry and diminishing the industry. And without 57% of GDP or 50 plus coming from the financial services industry, you know, the outlook for Cayman is somewhat bleak. And so, you know, we obviously want as an industry to work with you, to assist you to get better funding, to assist us to get better funding, but more importantly, to have a deeper engagement to allow us to support this industry and secure its future. But I'm grateful to each of you for being here today, and I have great respect for the Chamber of Commerce, having previously been engaged with it. But it really is a critical issue that the government invest in the ministry and in turn in the industry going forward.
Well, my short response is I agree. And that's why I fought so hard to get what we have today. And as I said in my opening speech, I will continue to do that as and when necessary. And anymore, I think my colleagues know, and anybody that know me on a personal level, when I say something, I will do it. I don't make promises I can't keep. That's the other thing. But certainly, I, you know, in other words, the government absolutely recognizes from the premier on down. Financing, obviously, is one thing, we're trying to address that, but actually making sure that we're delivering on financing that we do have, delivering on initiatives, and making sure that we have the innovation to be the advocates, making sure that we each play our part and figure out what that part is going to be critical too. And that's the thing that I hope that we're developing through these engagement initiatives, and as I said, they're going to have enough pain more so than not, because we're engaging at the level of making sure the policymakers, the people that have the power of the pen from the UK to Europe to the US, and we just came back from an action-packed two-day engagement with very, very senior members of the policy team in both Congress and the Senate, and actually had an opportunity to meet some congressmen themselves. So, and that's why the essence and the thrust of what I said in my, that just reinforced we all have a role to play in making sure that the world knows that the 1984 or 80s film that will remain nameless is a Hollywood fiction. But in many respects, that is still the reality in people's minds. And it's because we've done a great job just doing what we're doing, being excellent, being compliant. We need to continue to do that. But we also now need to make people understand that's what we're doing, how we're doing it, and how we benefit. And so therefore, as much as it takes in terms of investment, I will go to bat, I will try. It's not going to be a hard sell, but we have to very quickly, government and industry, figure out what that effective strategy is going to be to make the greatest impact. Industry to industry, government to government, industry to local, because to your point, convincing all politics is local. We need to continue to ensure that the Cayman Islands understand and appreciate the importance of this industry to our survival economy, so it will be an easier sell, and we won't have necessarily the political detractors asking, why are you putting money towards financial services and not education and not health? And that's where, again, we need your help, we need your support to continue to do those efforts that you're doing to educating the public in whatever spheres of influence that they say that you do have.
All right, Minister Madness, thank you very much. And that's a good segue to what you just mentioned there. Number one, all politics is local. And at the very beginning, you said something quite clear that financial services industry is part of an integrated whole that comprises the nation we're building here. Minister, something has come to light to me, and I've become acutely aware of it, and I would say painfully aware of it, in which the financial services industry actually has an important solution, I believe, for the tourism industry, which, as you know, is the industry in which I spend most of my working day. And that is, as you may be aware, in the Cayman Islands and our tourism industry, we've got three categories of licensed properties that provide tourism accommodation, and they're categorized as hotel, apartment, and guest house. Those are technically the legal definitions on which we're licensed. Of all of the bed places, in other words, the number of people we can sleep at beds, 47% of them are in hotels. Hotels comprise of the total licensed properties about 3% of the property count, licensed property count. The rest are categorized as either apartments or guest houses. And the number of beds that they accommodate, bed places for apartments or guest houses, is 53% of the tourism accommodation. And here's something that's hit us just very, very recently. As I say, for me, it was in the last day. A lot of us in that space advertise our properties, rent the properties, collect the funds for the properties, in some cases through various gateways. But the predominant gateway in the space I'm talking about is provided by something called HomeAway, VRBO, Vacation Rental by Owner, and actually that one, Expedia. So it's a large umbrella organization. That organization has taken a decision that for any renewals of subscriptions which come up all the way through the year, no renewals are going to take place unless we set up that the collection for the payment for the accommodation is through that umbrella organization. That's fine. It's actually their facility. It'll give better customer service, but we're going to big stumbling block that the people in this room somehow have to be involved in. They apparently can only do that for us if we can provide them with an IBAN number, an international banking account number. I've worked with them for hours on the phone trying to solve this. The sad fact is that those of us who are Cayman-based, living in Cayman, want to operate Cayman Islands-based bank accounts, do not have that facility. And we're in trouble because what happens if we lose the RBO, HomeAway, and Expedia representation, which is, as I say, it's up to 53% of our accommodation. And what I was very shocked to learn is that Cayman doesn't have it, but yet several other places with which you're competing do have it. Some onshore jurisdictions, as well as some other jurisdictions that are, you might be surprised, the British Virgin Islands has it. Now, I don't know whether the solution is with the industry. I don't know whether the responsibility falls on the government, the lobby to get this in place, or whether it's something that's regulatory that needs to be worked on. But I can tell you, this is desperate. right? Because those of us who are in the space who don't have access to using the bank account in some other country which has ID numbers are in dire straits right now. And I'm sorry to be alarmist, but it got me pretty alarmed when this hit me yesterday. I was able to get an extension for the property I'm involved in for 1 month. And in that period of time, we don't figure this thing out.
Thanks a lot. Closing remarks are very brief so we can go. Please join me in thanking the entire panel for and secondly, as I mentioned earlier in my remarks, Chamber is carrying on a series of roundtable discussions. We already started with the construction industry. We had a very good session with them a month ago. From those reports, we're able to glean what some of the issues are with that particular industry. And then we, the Chamber Council, meets regularly with the government, so we meet with the Cabinet. We met to meet quarterly, and we also disagree with the Minister of Commerce to meet with that minister and senior officials in the Minister of Commerce on a quarterly basis as well. That is how we represent the issues that you present to us as a Chamber. That is how we represent you. We take the policy advocacy of the Chamber's role extremely seriously. And so our next sessions are going to be on the tourism sector, and of course also on the financial services industry. We'll be talking to Cayman Finance specifically to collaborate and coordinate on that session. But the point of those sessions is for you, the industry, to speak freely about some of the threats, issues, and opportunities that you see. And the point of the entire exercise is for us to put that together and present that to policymakers to ensure that you have a say in the policy environment that your business operates in. Aside from that, thank you very much for attending and enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you.
We look forward to seeing many of you out on Saturday for our birthday.